James Farr here, live from Pasadena Media Studios. Get ready for more piercing and provocative conversation. Live starts now. And welcome to The Conversation Live. The Conversation Live focuses on social justice, restorative justice, inclusion, and equality. Today we're going to unpack and have a very critical and uncomfortable conversation. This week on The Conversation Live, Pastor Lucius Smith from Friendship Pasadena Church and LaCora Stevens, host of the widely popular Yes Show, are in the seat. We're going to inside the Black Church, up for debate, this cornerstone of the Black community becoming irrelevant and even impotent. why so much church hurt, and can the church return as it was a generation ago? Let's roll in this first clip and we'll figure it out.
people being judged, looking at their past and the way they walk, the way they talk, or the way they might, you know, carry themselves, because everybody got a past.
It's a feeling that you really can't explain. You feel lonely. You know, you feel as if you have no one, because you feel as if the world doesn't accept you. So you're looking for that place of hope. And then when you enter into the church and you don't get that, you feel alone and abandoned. So it's like, what do I do at this point? God, are you real?
I don't think the church should have to take the blame and the stain for what crazy individuals have done to you.
Now, and I'm going to jump right back over to you with you, Pastor Smith, but I got to say, some of the most evil, vile, wicked things I've ever seen in my life have happened inside of the four walls of a church.
Okay.
I was so insulated.
Right.
I couldn't go outside. I couldn't be here. I couldn't be there. But what I did experience was right there. I learned everything the world had to teach me.
Right. Well, and, you know, not to excuse bad behavior, and as a representative of a church, you know, I would apologize to you for how you were mistreated and how things didn't get done. Because on the flip side, and again, not to compare churches, but at Friendship some years ago, we had a allegation of abuse between a husband and a wife. And just the allegation, because both of them were in positions of leadership, we sat them both down while we investigated it. Mm. Because we didn't want it to be said that something was said and you didn't speak to that. So again, we're talking about how different congregations, you know, work and operate. But when you think about, you know, church, church is a gathering of people who are all basically we begin in sin, and some of us bring that sin into the church. Now, if the church, again, the ministry of the church is to bring people, minister to them in their brokenness, not to justify it and not just to allow them to continue in it. But if you come into a church looking for perfect people, then you set yourself up for disappointment. What's going on, and maybe this is part of what the relevant thing with the church is sometimes is that we try to be so concerned about social justice and political issues and other things that we forget that the goal and role is to bring people into the presence of Jesus. And so when we substitute that, then of course the generations that don't understand how my generation came to know him, I put my tradition as this is how, as opposed to this is why. And I think that many churches are married to the how we do a thing as opposed to why. There's going to be hurt people. There's going to be broken people. And if you're broken and someone else is broken, when our brokenness meets, then it might be a mess. But the goal of the church is to seek to minister to broken people, bring them out of that brokenness, and then hopefully you send them back out into the world, not under the cover of I've never been broken, but I've struggled. I've had my addictions. Here's my war wounds. And if the world sees people who have been broken, who have been healed and blessed by the church, then maybe the church will be more relevant to them. That if you're sick, if you're broken, and I can bring you to a person that can fix that, you're gonna line up, not for my church.
Well, but what many millennials are saying is that they just don't get the connection.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Right.
It's a bit abstract.
Right.
You know, even the idea of God and Christ could be abstract because they can't touch it.
Right.
So, I mean, how do you bridge that gap? Because they come into the space, maybe misunderstandings should come as you are, you know, in the context of what that actually means.
Right.
But, you know, a brother shows up with his hat on,
right,
in his jeans,
right,
and the old deacon tap him on the shoulder,
and he might get checked at the door,
and tell him take your hat off,
right.
And I'm speaking from personal experience.
No,
you know what I mean? I'm like, man, I'm sitting here with my family,
right.
Shouldn't we be celebrating that I'm at least here?
Exactly.
You know what I mean? So we talk about customs and traditions. How do we kind of loosen that up so that, you know, someone like LaCour may find a way to better identify with being in the space?
For churches in general, again, and I'm not trying to speak for everybody. I think many churches are more or as interested in, again, how a thing is done as opposed to why. In 1925, when Friendship was built, words were built, that was the heart of the black neighborhood. So it was very easy to catch, air quote, black Baptists. And so we could keep doing the thing that caught black Baptists in 2019, but the lake is stocked with a different type of fish. So I'm called to catch fish. Mm-hmm. And if I'm more engaged in how I catch a fish as opposed to why, then I'll continue to use my old methods. So people are coming into churches, and I've had this thing where we are doing 8-track ministry in a live streaming world.
Yeah.
But the goal is for you to hear the music, right?
Right. Mm-hmm.
But no, you got to hear it like this. You got to stand mm-hmm, like this. Mm-hmm. And that's where I think the disconnect comes, is people come in, they don't understand the terminology. They don't understand anything. Mm-hmm. And what we are trying to do, and what I think a lot of churches that are really thinking about how to catch fish, is strip all that stuff out of the way. It means a lot to me. Mm-hmm. And I know I got to stop patting this. It means a lot to me how I came to my relationship mm-hmm. with God. But
your path may be different.
And that's what I have to acknowledge.
Than somebody else's path.
Right. Right. And then, the goal is to get you into the presence of the Lord. So how it's done is up for grabs.
So am I less saved if I choose to watch you live stream versus
yes.
coming into
yes.
Yes. Come on, Pastor.
Why did you say that?
I just said that just again. No.
I could app in my tithes and offerings.
Right. Right.
Now, that is the dynamic of the generation, and there's nothing inherently wrong with that. But mm-hmm. a generation like mine would tell you, like the Word tells you, that there's nothing like fellowship. Like, I could watch this Dear Sister show and get all kinds of, you know, feelings and information. Mm-hmm. But sitting here and being in her presence, there's fellowship. Something completely, the real fellowship. Mm-hmm. You can't fellowship,
ooh,
one, with 1,000 people in a room.
Yeah.
And it's hard to fellowship with a TV.
So but a millennial, a teenager,
mm-hmm. right.
would argue that you are absolutely wrong.
Right.
Because their social interaction now may come through
right.
digital.
Yeah.
The sensation.
Which there are alternatives that I think that the church should consider.
Okay.
You understand
absolutely.
What I'm saying?
Absolutely.
Because you just said something. You said real fellowship.
Okay.
Church is very cliquish, brother.
Absolutely. Woo. Absolutely.
So,
amen.
Like, especially as a young woman, especially now as a young single woman, even
okay.
before, I remember prior, just trying to find the outlet. Because
yeah.
you don't want us to go to the club, right? I shouldn't be at the club, at the strip club, or
no,
anything
sure.
like that, right.
right?
I should find myself with like-minded people,
exactly.
fellowshipping with them.
Exactly.
But because the church cannot be real, it could be very fake.
Mm-hmm.
We like to put up these facades a lot.
Absolutely.
You know, and then now I'm here with a bunch of people with these masks on mm-hmm. at a facade, and
right.
then there's nowhere to go, only Bible study and Sunday morning service.
Right.
And I'm like, well, where are the outlets for the millennials?
Right.
What are we doing? And I think that we have to think outside of the box as
right.
pastors and elders and leaders as to how can we accommodate this new world, these new youngsters.
I mean,
but if you think about
father's generation. I'd like to say they came from an oppressive gospel
okay.
doctrine.
Oh, yeah.
Right.
You know what I mean? Everything,
right.
like if you're not here.
Right. Then, yeah.
7 days a week,
right.
sun up three times on Sunday, you
right.
wasn't saved, you wasn't worthy.
Right.
You were made to feel guilty.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Like you had.
That came from
something.
A generation time, though.
Mm-hmm.
But even if we're talking about masks, you know, do people have mask shirts? But I'm sure folks have their club mask.
Mm-hmm.
And what we're finding is that every generation is dealing with the fakeness mm-hmm. of where they are. So you have an increase in suicide, you have an increase
yes.
of depression
yes.
and anxiety. That's, you know, that's across the board. The church should be a place where I can come and look at your brokenness, you can come and look at mine, and not to justify, but man, we're both struggling. My struggle may not be yours, but let's work this thing out together. Listen to me. I'll listen to you. I'm not going to talk at you.
Mm-hmm.
Let's talk with each other. The churches talk at people for too long.
Let me check in real quick. You're watching The Conversation Live. The Conversation Live focuses on social justice, restorative justice, inclusion, and equality. My guest is Pastor Lucius Smith, pastor of Friendship Pasadena Church, as well as LaClora Stevens, who is the host of the Yes Show, Young, Entertaining, and Saved. A very good show. I suggest you check it out. We're getting ready to get out of here. We got about maybe 4 or 5 more minutes.
What?
Yeah, it goes by so quick.
Dang.
I got to make sure that we get to this point.
I don't think your brother loves us.
Oh, no.
Can the church return back to being a change agent? A warrior for social justice or injustice that you may have saw a generation ago. I mean, you met Dr. Martin Luther King.
Yes.
What?
as a kid?
I was six. I was six. Yeah. I was very active in the struggle.
But you also, in the contemporary, just 2 weeks ago, had the Honorable Elijah Cummings.
Yes, we did.
You know, speak at Friendship. Jared, go ahead and cue up that Cummings video, and then we'll come right back into it.
Today, I want to lead our church in the conversation because I am concerned that the American church has a proclivity of taking mops and mopping floors of mercy. So we have so consumed with mercy ministry. But I am here to tell you, if you mop with mercy, inevitably you will never ever identify the root problem of injustice. Churches cannot just be consumed with mopping floors of mercy. At some point, we've got to identify in our society the root problem of systemic injustice and remove the stopper. I want us to be a church that's just not consumed with mopping floors of mercy. We've got to be a church that rises up and pursues to tear down systemic injustice.
That's what they did a generation ago. That was the wrong video.
Okay.
But we'll go ahead and roll with it. I was going to end out with that. But a generation ago, that was the agency that the church had.
Right.
It was out there in them streets. Mm-hmm. It was advocating for social justice and change and desegregation amongst a myriad of other things. Can they go back, LaCour? Do you see hope
well,
for that?
Well, I guess one thing about it, I'm tired of it always being on the backs of black churches. White churches, where are you? What are you doing?
Well,
I'd say white churches, where are you? What are you doing? Because it always seems to be on our backs, the church. Now, I'm no elder, no pastor, no bishop, or anything like that. But I do feel that, yes, it can go back, number one. Absolutely, it can. Stop worrying about, you know, how large you could get your church, how much millions you could get, what debt you could have, things like that. Absolutely. It can go back. But I do feel that it's 2019. I think that all God's people should be working together, and it should just not be the black church's responsibility.
That's what we'll say, you, Pastor.
Well, I'll close with a
whenever a pastor verse. Say he gonna hurry to a close.
I'm gonna hurry to my third
point. Right.
Jesus said, and preachers love this, the harvest is plentiful, but the laborers is few. Ask ye therefore the Lord of the harvest that he would send laborers out into the harvest field. And I didn't go to seminary, but I learned some things about the word ask and send. The word ask is to beg, is to plead, that the harvest is so plentiful and so ripe and so necessary to be reaped. He said, beg with God that he would send. That word is ekbalo. It means to forcibly eject, to thrust forth, to cast out laborers. We ask people, will you go and make a difference? That's not what Jesus said. He says, pray that God will ultimately grab the church by the scruff of its neck and throw us out there, because the world is dying while we're singing Amazing Grace as I take my seat.
All right, well, we're going to park it right there. You know, one of the things, like I said, I would like to see the church return back to its prominence in leading the charge. Black church, white church, but right now we're having a family conversation.
Yeah.
I'm talking about
Jamal Bryan is trying to do some things.
Many are. I mean, I'm not saying that there aren't in the space that aren't doing it, but it's just not, you know, there's a generational
not
gap.
Not unified. And it is,
the younger people don't feel welcomed.
Yeah.
You know, here in Pasadena, you're probably seeing this much more. Your parishioners are commuters. They're not locally in the area.
Right.
And there's so much more that we can get into, but I got to get out of here because we're on a hard break.
Right.
So again, you're watching The Conversation Live. I'm your host, James Farr. The Conversation Live focuses on social justice, restorative justice, inclusion, and equality. Until we have another opportunity to speak with you, as always, agape.
The Conversation Live is brought to you by